Hello everyone, I'm Shaolin Rogue, and welcome to the first bootcamp edition of The Machine. Throughout the bootcamp series, we'll be introducing you to the various robots and weapons available. We'll compare their strengths and weaknesses, and discuss some basic strategy along the way. Hopefully this series will help new pilots get off to a good start, and with that, let's get down to it. We're going to start bootcamp off with the first mech that everybody gets to pilot, the good old Destrier. Two small weapon slots, it's pretty quick, decent amount of HP to get you started, and has similar weapon loadout options and playstyle to the higher end Gepard and Stalker. A stock Destrier comes with a level 1 Spiral and a level 1 Malot. As you can see, the Destrier is a fairly quick and agile little bot. It's relatively small, you're not going to catch a lot of aphids, noricom fire, and be able to duck behind low cover. We'll come up here and show you the corner firing of the Destrier. Not bad. There's certainly bots out there that are better, but most of your body is kept out of view. If you're careful, you can definitely use that to your advantage. Okay, it's time to get into some weapons demonstrations. To start off with, we're going to go with an upgraded version of your stock loadout. A level 5 Spiral and a level 5 Malot. The Malot and Spiral combination gives you some nice range and options. The Malot has a maximum range of 800 meters, and you'll start noticing it doing decent damage at around 600 meters or so when you start missing less. The Spiral has a 600 meter range. There's a small lock-on time before you can fire, but you can fire from behind cover. It'll curve around obstacles and up over small buildings without a problem. Being a homing missile, you will get a guaranteed hit as long as you don't run into an obstacle. There is no splash damage. This is a nice open map, so it's a good time to talk about general game objectives. Priority one is beacons. You'll notice the red and blue beams going up into the sky. Those are certain strategic points on the map that you have to capture and hopefully maintain control. The more beacons you have, the slower your team's stamina bar will deplete. That would be the red blue bars at the top of the screen opposite the timer. If you have more control points than the enemy, their bar will decrease faster than yours, which is the primary method of winning a match. You can also win a match by destroying all the enemy bots on the other team, or if the timer runs down, whoever has controlled the most beacons has the most stamina bar left, that team will be declared the winner. When you spawn into a map, you're going to notice that you generally have two beacons closest to your spawn point, and the enemy team will have two beacons closer to their spawn point. There will be a somewhat central beacon, which is usually the main focus of the battle. Other effective strategies would include flanking or going around the enemy's front line to grab one of their home beacons. This will not only speed up the depletion of the enemy team's stamina bar, it will usually also force the enemy team to go on the defensive, dividing their forces between the two beacons, making them much easier to overcome. Of course, if you have the opportunity, you can always push to the enemy spawn point and destroy all their bots, or mech them out. A risky maneuver when playing solo, as you can never be sure if your random teammates are going to cover you and the beacons during the offensive, but can be a very effective strategy when playing with a squad or in your claim. As you can see, this weapon's configuration doesn't deal a ton of damage. It'd be well suited for mid-range support, wanting to stay between 5 and 600 meters at your effective range, while staying out of the reach of more powerful short-range weapons. Next up, we're going to try a beacon capping setup with dual Punishers. The Punisher has a higher rate of fire and a larger magazine than the Malot. It has a maximum range of 500 meters, but due to a very wide bullet spread, you're not going to notice any decent damage until you get within the 300 meter range. Early on, this is your go-to gun for beacon capping and close quarters combat. I'd recommend new pilots upgrade their weapons to level 5 first before they start to upgrade their mechs. This is going to help you take enemy mechs apart faster, allowing you to survive more firefights and be more effective on the battlefield. Upgrading this Punisher to level 5 has brought a modest increase in damage. It may not look like much, but keep in mind that's per bullet, and it definitely adds up to make a noticeable difference. Alright, it's time to go check out some beacon capping with the Destrier and Punisher setup. In the early levels, I'd recommend that pilots go for beacons first. The majority of pilots are still learning how to steer their mechs, don't really understand quite how the beacon and stamina bar system works, spending the entire match standing around shooting each other. This leaves all the beacons wide open for you to cap. Capping the majority of beacons in a match will get you the beacon capping medal, which awards you 5 gold, which you can start saving towards opening up new hangar slots and upgrading your bots and weapons. A good general strategy for new pilots is to focus on capping beacons in the beginning of the match, getting minimum of 3, maybe 4 beacons to start, then turn your attention to damaging the enemy. This may very well get you a top damage award as well, resulting in 10 gold per match as long as your team wins. Alright, we're going to grab our second beacon here. Keep an eye on the enemy while we're moving. A quick tip on maneuvering, try to avoid moving straight sideways and back. If you keep those legs moving in an oval type of pattern, the diagonal corners turn much quicker than a full 90 degree swivel. Make sure you're using cover to avoid fire and damage as much as possible. Try to corner shoot and wear your enemy down before you come out and finish them off with all your weapons. Okay, we'll see what's going on with the center beacon over there. Not going to be able to make the trip across without getting taken apart by this Patton over here. Now he has the ECU shield there. Unfortunately, he's going to block most of our bullets, and at this weapon level, it takes a long time to wear down an ECU, so we'll just try and keep out of his line of fire while we work on some of his teammates here and see if we can't get him to expose himself. Now you can see at close range, the Punisher does much better damage. When using them, you're going to want to try and close in on your enemy, utilizing cover as much as possible. Try and get them to empty a clip and advance during their reload time. Now, the next loadout that we're going to try is the dual Malot. I find it very effective to trade the Spiral for a second Malot. It simplifies your aiming firing time, and you can strategically time your reloads popping in and out of cover much easier. We'll briefly show you here the difference in damage when you upgrade the Malot from a level 1 to level 5, and remember that that is per bullet, and that increase is going to be across 2 guns. I apologize, it's a 4 and a 5 and not 2 level 5s, but that's what I had sitting around in the cupboard. Time to get into some more gameplay footage. The Malot is going to work best when you start firing inside your maximum range of 800 meters and keep your guns focused on your target. Close range into about 600 or so. I'd recommend not going under 500 meters. You will get an increase in damage and accuracy. However, that will put you within the range of much more powerful weapons. Avoid standing out in the middle of an open space firing your guns like Rambo. It's a pretty poor strategy. Instead, look for targets that aren't paying attention and try and time your reloads so that as you run out of bullets, you're already on your way back to cover. When using medium to long range weapons, your primary function is support, covering your faster, heavily armed teammates as they capture beacons for the team. And if beacons is what you want to go for, then I would recommend that you outfit your Destrier with a pair of Pintas as soon as you reach level 5. The damage you see listed is per rocket. The Pinta fires 16 separate rockets pretty much at the same time. There's a slight delay. They're relatively fast, but the smaller, lighter mechs running directly backwards can outrun the Pintas. Make sure you get really close for maximum damage. With a 15 second reload time, it's definitely a hit and run weapon, and make sure you've got your escape planned before your attack. Pintas also have a small splash radius, making them excellent for leading your enemy around a corner and firing, getting out of the way before he can bring his weapons to bear on you. When facing off against another opponent with a 300 meter rocket weapon like this, try to maneuver your bot so you're dipping just within the 300 meter range to fire your weapons and getting back out of range to avoid enemy fire. Time to see the Pinta in action. Power Plane is an excellent map for this weapon. Lots of tight spaces and corners so that you can utilize that splash damage. As you're maneuvering within your 300 meter range, you're going to want to use the buildings for cover and avoid these long shooting lanes that you see here. Heavy type weapon at extreme range can wreck your poor little Destrier before you get close to make a dent with your rockets. Okay, we can see that Cossack's got the beacons over there. We're going to let him have both of those since he's obviously going to be focusing on that. And you just want to check out the ranges of all the bad guys as you approach. See where your teammates are, what kind of mechs you have to support you, and what directions they're heading off into. Alright, seems we have our first victim right here. And you want to try and get him right away, and get behind cover while you reload. Good damage for two small weapons. You can see it can be very effective as long as you play smart. And here comes a golem to prove that point for us. With a high risk, high reward weapon like the Pinta, situational awareness is key. Alright, we'll give this another go. An open map like Canyon or Springfield can be a challenging for a short range weapon like the Pinta. As long as you approach carefully and find an effective location where you can work your range to your advantage, play to the strengths of your weapons, you should be able to do okay, and hopefully we can show you a bit of that. Again, we're going to check all the enemies out on our way in, and you're going to want to try and use structures as much as possible to keep you out of the range of snipers. Okay, so we're going to try and work down in this area for a while. The trick in this location is you want to keep that beacon blue, so you may have to backpedal to park on it and keep it from changing. But at the same time, you're going to need to move out to deal some damage. Let's see if we can sneak around the corner here. Now, the nice thing about the splash, it will damage the enemy despite his ECU shield, and they're excellent for dealing critical hits. As you can see, we've popped off two of his weapons. Use your smaller bot's speed to outrun the turning speed of the turret of the bot you're facing if possible. And we're going to let him go because he doesn't have a lot of health, and to be honest, in this game, it's not really about kills, it's about damage done if you're trying to earn yourself gold and improve your rank. That being said, if there's a particularly troublesome nasty bot, it's a good idea to take him out and move on. Alright, we got this Cossack here. Now, you kind of have to read the pilot a bit, see if he's looking twitchy like he's about to jump. Sometimes you want to wait for them to jump and take advantage of the slight delay upon landing. We're just keeping an eye on everybody, see who's close. Take a moment to assess the situation and move in. Now with close range weapons, a high reload time, and a quick bot, you need to play this like you're an ambush predator. You're gonna hopefully swoop in when people aren't paying attention, strike, and then leave before they even know what hit them. Now we seem to have control of the middle ground, so we can get a bit more aggressive and push forward to one of their home beacons. Alright, we'll take this guy out so that our teammates there can move forward. We'll grab this beacon here. That'll speed up the depletion of the red team's stamina bar, increasing the pressure. Now at this point we have capped three of the beacons. That's enough to secure us the top beacon capping award of 5 gold. So we can move on to working on getting another 5 gold for damage done and see if we can't shorten this match, maybe mech this team out. We're right near the end here, so we're going to risk our mech and just try and get as much damage in before the clock runs down. We wouldn't make it back with another mech in time. And you can see there I was running straight backwards and not all of his rockets hit me. So that's the Pinta, definitely an excellent close quarters combat weapon, and used effectively, you can skirt around the edges of wide open spaces. Moving back out to medium range, we're going to have a look at the Pin. The Pin is an unguided rocket type weapon similar to the Pinta, however you get a longer range and will do less damage. It has a shorter reload time than the Pinta, and also has a larger splash radius. The larger radius is going to allow you to easier damage enemy robots hiding around corners. It'll allow you to damage through physical shields, and on some maps, be able to damage opponents through thin cover. Here we are once again on Canyon, which is an excellent map for the Pin. With its narrow cover and long sight lines, the angles really play into the strengths of a splash type weapon. We'll go ahead and grab this beacon. And it looks like all the action's towards the middle, so we'll head over that way. And here's where you're going to use the speed of your light bot to your advantage. They're all quite focused on my teammates up top. We'll start flanking them around the outside here. So again, just like playing the Pinta, you're going to want to run around, unloading your weapons as soon as they're ready to fire, and try not to get noticed. We're going to let our teammates finish this Gepard off. He's so close to death, it'd be a waste of the damage that we have in our full magazines. There's a good target right there. We're going to show you the Magnum next. It's a plasma weapon. It has no reload time. You're not going to be able to get this right away, as you have to wait till you reach level 20 and then save up the workshop points to start collecting them. They're definitely worthwhile though, as you level these up, and they're a staple of most close quarter combat builds and can be used on many bots, including the Gepard and Stalker that you're going to be graduating to if you really like the playstyle of the Destrier. Back to gameplay footage. Now the Magnum is going to really allow you to take advantage of the speed and agility of your smaller bot. Definitely you're going to want to utilize the corner firing available, wearing your opponents down from cover and stepping out to finish them off. You'll want to constantly be on the move, ducking in and out of cover, making strafing runs, using your speed to break cover and finish them off while their weapons are reloading. There really isn't much else to say about the Magnum other than to get plenty, get them leveled. They're one of the most effective weapons in the game. We're going to skip the AT Spiral, as really I feel that the Patton or maybe a Griffin with Hydras are the only type of bots that those are effective on. They do little damage individually, and you really need a cluster to be effective. Which brings us last, and certainly least, to everyone's favorite weapon to hate, the Noricum. At first glance, this weapon looks good. Extreme range, not a bad reload time comparable to a Pinta, and lots of damage. Even with splash damage, due to the extreme spread of the projectiles, you only wind up hitting a bot with one, sometimes two, of the rounds. In order to hit any more than that, it'll be a bigger bot, and it still won't make an effective dent. My best advice is not to bother with this weapon unless they seriously change it. But if you must, the least I can do is leave you with a small tutorial. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.